Simon & Schuster Audio presents SOG, The Secret Wars of America's Commandos in Vietnam by John Plaster. Read by Arthur Morey. I'd like to have two armies, one for display with lovely guns, tanks, little soldiers, staffs, distinguished and doddering generals, and dear little regimental officers who would be deeply concerned over their generals' bowel movements or their colonels' piles, an army that would be shown for a modest fee on every fairground in the country. The other would be the real one, composed entirely of young enthusiasts in camouflage uniforms who would not be put on display, but from whom impossible efforts would be demanded and to whom all sorts of tricks would be taught. That's the army in which I should like to fight. Jean Lategui, soldier and writer. 1. Colby's Secret War. It was a miserable sea, yet navigable despite the looming islands and the swells that propelled the heaving 38-foot junk. February was well into North Vietnam's monsoon season, and when there weren't full-fledged typhoons, there were squalls and showers, day after day. Wretched conditions for small craft like this junk, but people must eat, so fish must be caught. Despite the modern times, February 1961, the bobbing boat had been hand-built in the Vietnamese tradition, crafted by the very half-dozen men who manned her. Wooden-hulled and two-masted, above deck she had just a small, squarish wheelhouse aft, and like all North Vietnamese fishing boats, displayed proudly communist red sails. They were her only propulsion. And because she lacked modern navigational instruments, her captain steered as had his ancestors for 10 generations by the stars. But in tonight's overcast, it was not his knowledge of the heavens, but his familiarity with the towering limestone islands around them that allowed him to steer closer to the seaside town of Cam Pha. Two nights earlier, they'd passed the glowing horizon that was Haiphong, North Vietnam's major port city, and this evening, during a quiet sunset, they could almost see the hazy mountains of Guangxi Province, China, some 40 miles northward. No other fishing boats braved tonight's squalls or teased the darkened reefs and shoals. On so miserable a night, surely no government craft could come to their rescue if they were swamped. But, on the other hand, neither would a communist Sua Tao-class patrol boat stop them and make difficult inquiries, which actually was their main concern. Despite its authentic appearance, this junk had been built not in North Vietnam, but 800 miles away at Vung Tau, South Vietnam. And while the men who made and manned her were once simple fishermen, in more recent years they'd become refugees who fled the communists, and even more recently, they'd been trained by CIA paramilitary officers who also had financed this entire expedition. When at last his junk reached calmer, leeside waters behind the jagged island, the captain called up a thin, middle-aged man from below. Several crewmen lowered over the side a small woven basket boat crammed with a radio and provisions, and off he went. Agent Ares, the CIA's first long-term North Vietnam-based operative, had been successfully landed. The man to whom Agent Ares ultimately reported was as much his opposite as was imaginable. Catholic, Ivy League, with intelligent eyes behind horn-rimmed glasses, William Colby looked and sounded more like a corporate executive than the CIA's Saigon station chief. Comfortable in a bow tie and business suit on even the sultriest tropical days, the man who oversaw this expanding covert enterprise hardly appeared to be a rising CIA star and longtime veteran of the secret wars. In 1944, then-Lieutenant William Colby had parachuted into Nazi-occupied France as one of the OSS's most elite operatives, a Jedburgh officer, to help the resistance disrupt German defenses behind the Normandy beaches. A year later, he was sabotaging Norwegian rail lines to prevent German units from reaching the Reich before its collapse, while several of his OSS colleagues became founders of U.S. Army Special Forces, Colby joined the new post-war civilian intelligence agency, the CIA. His career progressed steadily. Soon after Colby's 1959 appointment to the ever more important Saigon station, there began a troubling reappearance in South Vietnam of old communist Viet Minh fighters who had emigrated to the North in 1954 after the French Indochina War. At its April 1959 15th plenum, the North Vietnamese Communist Party Central Committee had voted in secret session to return covertly to South Vietnam thousands of such Viet Minh veterans. These infiltrators were to work with party cadres who'd remained in South Vietnam to execute a conquest intended from its inception to be deniable, and thus undercut any rationale for foreign intervention. To infiltrate on such a scale, the Central Committee created a special army unit, the 559th Transportation Group, the numbers commemorating its May 1959 founding, which in tandem with North Vietnam's Trinh Sat Secret Intelligence Service would train people and move them southward. From his headquarters in North Vietnam's Ha Tinh province, the infiltration commander, Brigadier General Vo Bam, cautioned, "This route must be kept absolutely secret." Therefore, when the first group headed south in August 1959, they wore untraceable peasant garb and carried captured French weapons. For the next 16 years, Hanoi insisted it had no role in the fighting in South Vietnam. The returning Viet Minh marched 10 miles each day among busy detachments of army engineers sent to improve and expand these simple footpaths they called the Trung Son Route, because it meandered through a similarly named mountain chain. Westerners would call this network the Ho Chi Minh Trail. CIA Station Chief Colby found gathering information about the Trung Son route difficult. Indeed, this landlocked Laotian wilderness was largely unmapped, with misty valleys so blanketed by jungle that flyovers and aerial photos disclosed nothing. To find what was there required putting men on the ground. The CIA recruited French coffee planters at Khe San on South Vietnam's northwest frontier to travel every few weeks along Route 9 to the quiet village of Che Pho Ne, Laos, 30 miles away. Despite keeping their eyes peeled, the planters brought back little intelligence because infiltration parties were small and crossed Highway 9 at night. The incoming Kennedy administration expanded Colby's covert effort to detect communist infiltration and insinuate an expanded network of CIA saboteurs and agents into North Vietnam. National Security Memorandum 52 authorized the CIA to employ Army Green Berets and Navy SEALs to train and advise the South Vietnamese who would execute Colby's covert missions. Technically, the Green Berets and SEALs weren't working for the CIA. They worked for CAS, an innocuous cover whose initials stood for Combined Area Studies. At the seaside resort town of Nha Trang, American Special Forces trained South Vietnamese 1st Observation Group commandos to explore the growing Ho Chi Minh Trail. During 1961 and 1962, the 1st Group mounted 41 recon operations into the Laotian infiltration corridor, but its teams were too cautious to learn much. The CIA-funded mountain scouts penetrated Laos, too. However, these courageous but illiterate Montagnard tribesmen could not comprehend map reading and couldn't associate what they discovered with a recordable location. Meanwhile, in Da Nang, the SEALs trained junk crews to land secret agents in the north and organized a civilian raiding force, the Sea Commandos, for hit-and-run coastal attacks. Soon, the Sea Commandos began across-the-beach raids on North Vietnam to plant a clever weapon designed by SEAL gunner's mate Barry Enoch. Enoch rigged a packboard with four cardboard tubes, each containing a 3.5-inch anti-tank rocket wired to a delay mechanism, so a raider could slip ashore at night, aim the packboard toward, say, a radar station, activate the timer, then paddle back to a waiting boat. The raiders would be long gone by the time the North Vietnamese got their sunrise surprise. After several successes, some raider junks were intercepted by enemy Swat Hao patrol boats, whose automatic cannons and heavy 12.7mm machine guns made quick work of the flimsy wooden craft. Alosiel gunner's mate Enoch devised a host of clever junk armaments, from hidden rocket launchers to 50-caliber machine guns concealed in 55-gallon drums. It soon reached the point that junks were just too vulnerable to ply North Vietnamese waters. The CIA began a search for faster boats, and turned as well to aerial infiltration via a new South Vietnamese Air Force unit. To command the clandestine VNAF squadron that would penetrate the North, Colby sought out a flamboyant pilot with a thin Clark Gable mustache and a penchant for black flight suits. Though only 30 years old, already he was a colonel and commanded Saigon's Tan Son Nhut Air Base and seemed willing to fly anything, anywhere. But did that
include... We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.